Welcome everyone. Welcome to Rising FinTech episode 3. Today we have Mr. Saad Niazi, who is the Chief Operating Officer of Kinu. I think most of you must be aware who he is. He's a mashallah legend in the industry. I've known Saad as a personal friend for a very, very long time. I've admired him for much longer because Saad kuch aise sarphire logon mein se hain जिन्होंने बैंकिंग इंडस्ट्री का बहुत खुशी जॉब छोड़ के बहुत पहले जब ये बात फैशनेबल नहीं थी इंडस्ट्री से बाहर गए वो बैंकिंग इंडस्ट्री से और उन्होंने ऐसे पेन पॉइंट में हाथ डाला जो आई पर्सनली बिलीव इज द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट एलिमेंट इन अनलॉकिंग द डिजिटल पेमेंट लैंडस्केप इन पाकिस्तान बहुत बहुत मुश्किल एरिया में साथ एग्जीक्यूट कर रहे हैं एंड Kinu इज एग्जीक्यूटिंग रियली रियली वेल सो होपफुली दिस इज गोइंग टू बी अ फन सेशन एज आई सेड इज अ पर्सनल फ्रेंड सो आई थिंक काफी कैजुअल सेशन रहेगा ये यू गाइज आर वेलकम टू प्लीज थ्रो अस क्यू एंड ए इंशाल्लाह वी विल हैव सम टाइम राइट एट द एंड टू मे बी टेक सम क्वेश्चंस अगर कोई बहुत जबरदस्त क्वेश्चंस आए तो हम बीच में भी ले लेंगे बट ये हमारे पार्टिसिपेंट्स और व्यूअर्स के स्किल के ऊपर है कि वो कितने मजेदार क्वेश्चंस हमारे तरफ भेजते हैं सो वेलकम साद
थैंक्स अ लॉट जी
सो साद जस्ट अ लिटिल बिट ऑफ एन इंट्रो अबाउट योरसेल्फ एंड आल्सो Kinu व्हाई एक्वायरिंग
बिफोर आई स्टार्ट पहले तो मैं कहूंगा जी इट वाज आई मीन थैंक्स अ लॉट फॉर सच काइंड वर्ड्स बट यू हैव बीन मोर देन जेनरस एज ऑलवेज अपार्ट फ्रॉम बीइंग अ पर्सनल फ्रेंड आई हैव ऑलवेज टेकन दिस इंस्पिरेशन फ्रॉम यू बिकॉज़ यू ऑलवेज हैव हैड लॉट ऑफ एनर्जी एंड आई न्यू फ्रॉम दैट वेरी पॉइंट टाइम दैट समडे यू विल आल्सो फॉलो द फुटस्टेप्स एंड यू विल आल्सो गेट आउट ऑफ द बैंकिंग एरिया एंड डू समथिंग न्यू एंड यू हियर I'll just cut to the chase and jump to the introduction. See, I've been associated with this industry since the last 15 years. Started my career from tech companies, then joined a bank in Pakistan, Faisal Bank. Was in the ADC department as it was known back then. So digital and everything else were always part of that particular department. The realization came while working at Faisal Bank that market size that we used to operate in was pretty small. Cards were the primary source of transactions back then because mobile channel was not very prevalent for obvious reasons. So what we knew was that the limited territory of the merchants that we operate on is not taking this industry any further. I mean, we'll be playing in a certain revenue in a certain revenue base, a certain P&L, and that's going to continue. And probably I was not cut out for that and was in search of like-minded people who could accept this. And luckily, all of that happened after a thought process of probably 3 to 4 years. All of that happened suddenly in 2013. Found the like-minded people who were willing to solve a problem. Acquiring, because you see, why acquiring? Why did we set out to solve the problem related to acquiring? You see, this is the basic infrastructure for digitization. As far as I'm concerned, I don't find that I would like to elaborate it this way, that cards are here to stay, just like cash is not going away that very sooner. But cards were making inroads. We were observing paradigm shift happening at a time when 2007-8 we used to hear people calling us and saying when we launched our Visa debit card, they used to say, कैसे अमेरिकन वीजा मिल गया एंड फ्रॉम दैट पॉइंट टू मॉम्स एंड एल्डरली लेडीज स्वाइपिंग देयर कार्ड्स ऑन आउटलेट्स व्हाइल चेकिंग देयर प्रोफाइल्स वी यूज्ड टू नो दैट द थिंग्स आर चेंजिंग बट द एवेन्यूज टू यूज दोस कार्ड्स आर इनफैक्ट श्रिंकिंग एट दैट वेरी पॉइंट टाइम आई रिमेंबर सिटी बैंक एंड स्टैंडर्ड चार्टर्ड दे पुल्ड आउट दे पुल्ड बैक फ्रॉम द एक्वायरिंग बिजनेस एंड द नंबर्स वर सेल्फ एक्सप्लेनेटरी वी हैड द लोएस्ट POS penetration per 1,000 adults in the entire world that way point in time. There was a big gap. We knew third parties have been successful in the acquiring business, but the basic the point was that how would we raise the amount of funds? Because generally, investments were never done in this area, and principally Pakistani investors generally invest in commodities or something that are more tangible in nature. So luckily found the right sponsors, found Mr. Ashraf Machara, Mr. Ejaz Hassan, and all of these guys were, very focused and very motivated, still are. So that is how we went about solving the acquiring related issue. Concept of Kinu was that, we have to be a multidimensional entity, which is a payments company, not to be known only as an acquiring entity. So Kinu is the fruit that represents, it's a multidimensional fruit. It's a hybrid fruit made out of tangerine and orange, and 95% of the world's Kinu is exported from Pakistan. And that was the motivation since day one. So firstly, the challenge was to solve the acquiring related issue. When we went into the acquiring business, we found out that, we are only processing plain vanilla purchase transactions. There is much more to that. A merchant needs much more to that. And we were able to leverage off that. Came about a separate issue altogether was the dollar. And when we move ahead and we'll discuss further, I'll come down to how we try to solve that. So Kinu is Kinu then introduced its local e-commerce gateway. Why local? Because you see, e-commerce still is not that big in Pakistan. I see a lot of potential. We all see a lot of potential now, especially post-COVID. So that e-commerce gateway is basically the stepping stone of bigger things to come. Pakistan has to go local sometime, and for us, this is the start.
Interesting. I think you made a point abhi touch kiya tha, which was you were saying that the merchant needs more than just plain vanilla POS acceptance. So what has been the secret of Kinu? Because main to jahan bhi jata hu mujhe Kinu ke terminals nazar aate hain, mashallah. So what's been the secret?
First and foremost, the service levels. Those are of the most important value. You see, if a merchant needs us on a Sunday, they will get our resource at their doorstep. We even repair or fix or change the machines. They're malfunctioning on a Sunday on an hour's notice. So that is the primary thing. A merchant needs service. They have to serve their customers, and we are supposedly more responsible for their customers when it comes to processing their payments. Second bit was, you see, every merchant has a different business, and that business has a separate set of requirements. Some want automation when it comes to, a lot of their reconciliations. Some require business to be generated between entities that are, and you see, Kinu was the only neutral entity in the market. Otherwise, the acquiring business is done by banks generally, and banks generally are reluctant in working with others, and they have their reasons. I'm not saying I don't respect that. They have their reasons. Kinu luckily was placed that way that we could allow loyalty points and all to be, meshed together and redeemed at a particular merchant. That means more business. Secondly, having our own tech team allows us to solve a lot of problems that a merchant have, which just by placing machines, you can't. Plus the application inside that POS machine is tailor-made for merchants of various types. So you see, our flexibility and our ability to go 3-4 levels deeper in providing solution to an individual merchant, I think that's the key. And that is how we were able to, even charge a little more, but offer them a great value. A lot of other initiatives are in line, and each are targeted towards, facilitating the merchant and hence getting business from them.
Excellent. So I think the secret is customer centricity. I think we rocket science nahi hai. And it's very easy to say every organization says that they're customer centric, but deliver karna is very, very difficult. And we know that service levels across the board in Pakistan in every area are generally very lacking, be it banking, e-commerce, acquiring players, as you mentioned, and so I think that it's important that young organizations like ours, for SadaPay, I think customers are absolutely the most important entity in the whole ecosystem. There is no question about that. So I think that your point is well made, that you looked at the pain points of the merchants and solved them. And merchants ki zindagi kafi difficult hai. It's not easy. And we as digital first players, we push them in areas where they're not comfortable. I mean, if you look at it, the learning curve for merchants to come on board new technologies is huge. I mean, the way QR was rolled out in Pakistan was a fiasco because you can't just implant something that worked in China. China is like another planet. It's not Earth, right? Especially when it comes to digital payments. And so to do something that happened there and try to replicate it the way it was done over there, bilkul exactly wohi cheez aap yahan laake musallat karne ki koshish karenge, it's just not going to work. What is your overall view on QR? Is it doable in Pakistan, impossible, or is there some tweaking that's required to do it better?
I believe so. That I'll slightly touch the QR bit. See, the basic problem is in our mindset, and when I say our mindset, I'm pointing out towards people like you and myself. See, targets and everything with regards to QR. See, that is the pressure we'll always have, but we have a huge responsibility. I always believe in one statement. I use it everywhere where I go. See, we need to understand there's no international solution to a local problem, right? Inspiration is always there. Timing of QR was very important. Why? It backfired, and probably it has left a very negative mark in our merchants' minds. And we know that for sure because we are the closest to a merchant that anybody could be. See, number one, what offering you were comparing, I mean, the market was comparing QR with cash, but it's in no way compared to cash. You know, cash is immediate and QR related settlements were a day later. That's the biggest issue, number one. Number two, you have to speak in their own language. Cash doesn't need a language. It's number literate. The apps were all in English. The merchants are not comfortable. You see, certain merchants, they feel offensive when it comes to English. You know, that's our culture. We need to adapt accordingly as well, and then launch certain kind of solutions. Coming to the other parts, knowing what universe the merchant belong to. See, merchants are pretty literate as well, but their main concern comes down to, is my money secure? Then the other point comes down to, is this religiously acceptable, whatever instrument you're bringing? Number three, the merchants generally expect some value out of it because you are, taking them away from cash. That is the bit that was missing and still is missing. When we talk about mass rollout and building an ecosystem, I'm not talking about cash in, cash out from merchant locations. I'm talking about merchants retaining their funds in an account. And the wallet company like yourself, when their customers go to a merchant, they can transact digitally without the need of any cash or change. Now that will require trust factor, religious accreditation, and will also require value against cash. Now cash has to be made less valuable. Unless that is done, the adoption will be very slower. People like us will have to work really, really hard and spend a lot of money. The viral coefficient is the key over here. That will only happen if we solve these three key problems.
Cash has to be made less valuable. Yes, that's an interesting statement. What do you mean by that? Because generally I get loyalty points, I get discounts as well.
तो मैं कार्ड को पुश कर रहा होता हूँ. Now just go back and go into the merchant's shoes. What does a merchant get out of accepting cards? Just the fact that, this particular merchant, I mean, he pays a merchant discount rate. If he does not pay a merchant discount rate, the viability of the entire transaction for an acquirer is nothing basically. Why would he place a machine over there anyways? So merchant is paying a merchant discount rate, which is the bread and butter. What does he get in return? Just the account, the cash management and the account in which the cash goes and gets settled, that's no value. They get it anyways. They can start transactions via check as well, by the way. right? Czech is legally very secure. Obviously, it has other problems as well. So at this very point in time, government intervention. Now, where Pakistan is standing right now, I'm not talking about 10 years ago or 6 years ago or the progress that we have made in this area. Where Pakistan stands right now, this is the right time for government to step in. I'm not talking about State Bank. State Bank has done more than enough and it has plans to do a lot of stuff. State Bank has been pivotal in this area, and they have worked with the entity with private entities very just like a partner, and they have solved a lot of issues. But the problem is the government has to incentivize the merchant. Right now the merchant is averse of paying tax. You have to change that mindset. The stick approach that government has always been using, it's not working out with the merchants anymore. See, the carrot is, why can't a merchant who does digital transaction get a rebate on GST? If that rebate is equivalent to the MDR, there is no loss, right? Secondly, a merchant transaction gets settled the next day, right? Why can't he get it instantly? Why is there a cost of fund attached to settlement? Now, because there is a cost of fund attached, I would never settle a merchant on the same very day. Now, that is where support is required. You see, the government has to, at this very point in time, understand that a slogan like Roti Kapda Makan and digitization, those are the four slogans for Pakistan, not three anymore. Because aaj hamari zarurat hai ki hum documented economy ka part ban jaye. I'm already late to ho hi chuke hain, lekin abhi game nikli nahi hai haath se. Agar humne aaj ye step le liye, to jo result humne itni mehnat ke baad as an industry 10 saal mein hasil kiye, we can achieve all that in 1 year. And God knows हम कहाँ होंगे आज से 4 साल बाद, और मैं पॉजिटिव बात के उसमें कह रहा हूँ. You see, the exponential growth has not been witnessed. What did branchless banking players? I'm really thankful to them. They have invested so heavily in Pakistan, and due to their investments, a lot of other businesses have propped up. But you see, what result did we get? The moment they stop putting in money, the viable and sustainable transaction goes out of the window. People will jump to cash. So sustainable measures are need to be taken, and that starts from number one, the government and publics realizing that, like the basic necessities for Pakistan, digitization and documentation are the essential things, right? Number two, when you do this, people start paying taxes. Whatever religious accreditation is required, why I've mentioned religious accreditation many times, and why I'm saying that, because I know for sure that still this time, when credit card volumes have skyrocketed and credit card, debit card volumes are processed on POS machines have pre-corona, they were around 330 billion a year. That has grown in double digits since 2012. It's still nothing. We all know it's nothing. It's a storm in a teacup, basically. So what we need to now realize is that this is the time for exponential growth, taking the 50,000 odd POS terminals to about 500,000 in the next 5 years. But that will require use cases. That will require intervention. That will require that people are incentivized and mandated to do digital transactions. Now, I'm not only talking about POS or acquiring. POS is the basic infrastructure. Sada Pay and entities like Sada Pay will leverage on those infrastructure, and they will then work on value adds as well, solving deep-rooted problems of customers. You know, that we probably don't even know of. Sada Pay would be replicating a wallet into a digital wallet, the wallet that I'm carrying right now into a digital wallet. And then there are a lot of use cases. Whatever I do from the money I take out from my wallet, Sada Pay will digitize it. But that digitization will require this basic infrastructure. So this is my take on it. You see, cash has to be made less valuable than the digital counterpart of it. And there are a lot of things I can later on in this conversation, I'll even try to mention what we have been sharing with the government and with State Bank.
Sure. I think this conversation has already been a hit. People love this slogan of yours, Roti Kapda Makan and digitization. So this is a viral webinar for sure. Saad, ye batao that recently State Bank, I think you mentioned as well that the role of the regulator has been extremely positive. We have found the regulator to be an extremely, extremely positive influence especially regarding the EMI regulations. We find those regulations to be brilliant. I think that execution is required, and that's on us. That's on companies like us. But as far as the regulation is concerned, you know, it's really everything you need to set up a payments bank, and then you can graduate to be a full digital bank. But you know, this is definitely a great stepping stone. They've also recently done something in the acquiring space, which apparently has a lot of value. And I'd like you to explain it a little bit more and a little bit in basic terms. I think a lot of experts are here on this webinar, but I think maybe if you can explain what has the regulator recently done in the acquiring space that we are all very excited about.
Sir, what happened was that, you know, being an acquiring player, we were engaged by State Bank in the last 5-6 years. Along with us, State Bank used to meet every player in the market, like they always do. The first question they always used to ask us was, why are we stuck at this number, this psychological number of 50,000 point of sale terminals? Our neighbor India is far ahead. Theek hai ji, we do give that excuse that India has a large population and a much more stable economy. But you see, acceptance and economy, in fact, acceptance network is a trigger towards better economy and towards better matrix that could be provided to banks for disbursement of loans effectively. But keeping that aside, Iran, on the other hand, grew from 10,000 POS terminals in 2008 to about 5 million in 2015. You see, 5 million. Yes, I'm not adding zeros. I'm roza nahi lag raha bhi mujhe. I'm being very factual over here. Aur wo ab badh ke, by the way, 6 million ho gaye. Kyun hua ye? Sahi ji, to ye question tha jo unke zehen mein bada rightly so aata tha. We and jab mujhse pucha gaya ji, I gave my point of view. I said the model is not viable. You see, the transaction eventually results in a loss for an acquiring entity. And when there is a loss, why would anybody make investments? And how could we as an entity attract investments? Because Pakistan ke over the last years, especially when we started doing this, ek bada mushkil time humne guzara war on terror ki wajah se. So investments were hard to attract. State Bank understood that. State Bank did a great job, and I really commend them that they invited all the players on a table. They formed an acquirers forum. I'm also a member. Kinu is a member of that, and so are other acquirers. They and everybody's voice synchronized, and we said the same thing. You see, the model is such that we need to understand. The other players are all issuers as well, obviously. The large acquirers are large issuers as well. They said, you see, our interchange income is basically, you know, 10 to probably 7, 8 or 10% of our total PNL. But our interchange income is not growing any further. It's just growing from the rate of inflation. It's not growing because the avenues of acceptance are so few. And even the large acquirers said that how could we expand when the model is such? So the basic problem was the interchange has to be controlled. The interchange regulation of associations are basically more suited towards the Western society, the way Western society works and the business works. Here, where there is undocumented economy at large, working on margins as low as 20, 30 or 50 rupees a piece, the MDR bit goes out of the window. How could anybody pay MDR? And where we are getting MDRs, there the turf wars between us, we are also part of that, had taken it down to a level that, you know, we were all vulnerable entities. I mean, I don't think any acquiring entity a year back could say that after 10 years they would still exist, even if the acquiring business belonged to a bank. It was proven when Citibank and Standard Chartered rolled the business back. So the problem was identified that you see, instead of going and fighting on rates, which is probably how Pakistan businesses start doing, we should be working on value additions. So the MDR was locked at 1.5, which means now Kinu will not fight for its place based on rate wars, which is probably the most pathetic idea in the world. We were culprits of the same, but it was a very bad idea of doing business. We rather would now focus on value additions. The value additions that we were earlier talking about, we'll focus our energies. How could we bring more traffic to a merchant location working with entities like you and like others, and then make money out of it, which is justified, right? Likewise, the interchange bit, it was locked because the interchanges were so surprisingly out of place that one type of card if it is swiped at a particular merchant location in a region, it would have a different interchange. So even I would say people who have been associated with the issuance business, it would not be on their fingertips. They do it every day. They look at the guidelines and SOCs and whatnot every day, but they can't figure it out. So it was simplified for calculation reasons. Likewise, what our responsibility is, State Bank has made it clear that entities like us would put their energies in expanding the POS network. And obviously with the expansion of POS network, several other things will open up. Especially, I would tell you what was a very difficult proposition in Pakistan was lending to the merchants. Disbursement of credit down to the lowest strata of the merchant. I think one entity, Hubble, is also doing a great job in this regard, and we are already working with them. They are digitizing the supply chain part of it, which was an opportunity that was begging, but was a very difficult task to do. They have taken the brave step of doing it. So, once the interchange and MDR are set aside, they are fixed. The acquiring entities now have the luxury and margins to make money and invest more in POS. But this will have an impact, but the impact will be very short-lived. In the next year or so, this impact will give a positive booster. I think from 50,000 odd, Pakistan should be able to, even in these circumstances, should be able to increase the machines overall to about 90,000 or 100,000, right?
In one year, inshallah,
I'm very hopeful because we are being very aggressive.
State Bank has given some specific targets to acquiring bank. Are you privy to that? What's that number?
See, that number is pretty high. I would say the market size would grow by about six times if those targets are met.
That's like 2023-24, right?
Yeah. But I think, but you will start seeing that change happening because already people are, that's natural process. When you have the luxury of a lucrative market, it's good that already five players were already there. Now they would put all their energies and they would go out and get more and more merchants on board, which is going to be very beneficial for the country and the industry overall. Other than that, you see, there are a lot of things that are to be done by the government, as I mentioned earlier. For example, a merchant that has never had a POS machine should be given some rebates. And I would tell you something very interesting, and you would understand what triggers a growth and what triggers exponential growth. You see, there was a debate going on, a big issue going on prior to COVID about 50,000 rupee of about a transaction that is above 50,000 rupee, a merchant has to collect a CNIC from a customer. Now there was no way that even the government had that, you know, how could you verify that transaction? How could you verify that CNIC? Now I could come up and say my name is Asad Niazi rather than Saad Niazi, and I would present a CNIC of a friend named Asad Niazi, right? I would simply say, here's my CNIC and I'm leaving. And the pictures on CNICs, you know, if you look at my picture, you'll think it's my son's picture on my CNIC, because in the last 8 years, because of acquiring business, I've aged 21 years, right? You always say that to me whenever we meet. So I'm just telling it to the audience. You see, this problem can easily be solved via a digital transaction. Any transaction that is 50,000 and above should be digital transaction. And there you go. Your problem is solved. Customer KYC is already done. The banks have all the trail. Why can't we buy a car that is worth 10 million rupees through our digital transaction? Why is it not happening? Now, obviously, the interchange rates and everything will change for that. And that is fine. We already have a chip and PIN mandate in place. All the cards all the banks have almost converted their cards into chip and PIN. For an additional amount of probably 500,000 or million, there could be an OTP as well. We all have that infrastructure in place. Now is the time to implement these. And you see, a radical move like this will trigger the growth. Like this, like this, there's no, I mean, you can't imagine how quickly people will adopt it. We learned this during one of our campaigns, that when you give, when you motivate people the right way, you don't even need to educate them. They strive and they approach people and they learn about the functionality themselves. You see, so that trigger is required. And Omar, one more thing, Iran did the same thing. You see, it was to my surprise, when we studied those case studies, we found out that in Iran, every adult used to get, I don't know about right now, but every adult used to get an oil subsidy of about $200 every month, right? Those subsidies were generally distributed through cash. And there were a lot of leakages, a lot of problems over there. The Ahmadinejad government back in 2010, I believe, and 11, they issued a regulation, and thereby they said this amount would be disbursed through cards. The first year was a mess. From the second year, they said, fine. Because the branches have become overcrowded, because ATMs have, you know, just depleted because of the high demand of taking out cash. They then allowed POS machines to be implemented, and they invited the POS vendors into their country and manufacture POSs. And right now in Iran, about 200,000 POSs are being manufactured every year. I mean, can you imagine the number? We have 50,000 POSs implemented. And in Iran, 200 and 250,000 POSs are manufactured in Iran by one of the manufacturers. So these, for Pakistan, there is no oil subsidy. So the trigger is the cash. Any transaction above a certain amount has to be a digital transaction, and you will see the change. I'll be, and you'll be a very rich man after that, by the way.
No, I love the fact that you give very clear direction. And I think two things that I've taken away from your talk right now is, basically, one is that GST rebate. I think that's a fantastic idea for any merchant that is doing digital payments. I think the GST rebate should come in. This kind of radical change requires government intervention. Private entities like us, we can only do so much. And I think that second idea of doing a transaction above a certain threshold completely digitally, that's also something that is definitely actionable and definitely will move the needle in the right direction.
Omar, one more thing. Omar, yeah. you see, there's one thing that is missing in Pakistan, and I would like to take this opportunity that, you know, there is no representation of a fintech as a body. I don't know if it could be a legislative body at the start. You see, why don't we form a Pakistan Fintech Association? Because you see, all these things that I'm talking about have been echoing. I've been voicing these, and several other people are voicing some other better things in various forms. But none of these get the priority that we think it should. And I think a Pakistan Fintech Association would be the body who everybody could join as an equal member, and, you know, put things that are worthy of the industry and change for the country. This, whatever role you give to us or Kino, but I think it should be formed immediately. You have been raising concerns regarding industry since a long time, and I think it's the right time that we immediately do it. Please, over to you.
I think I lost you there for a little bit. I think maybe some issues on my side, but I think the idea of a Pakistan Fintech Association is long overdue. I think there's enough players in the market with enough interests out there that we definitely need a forum where we need to have our voices heard in a coherent manner. I think that so kind of you to ask me to do it. I think there are a lot more senior people out there that maybe we can approach.
Trust me on this. I've been out of bank since the last 8 years now. And I know who's the best suited. And I think nobody better suited than you. Trust me. Otherwise, I would have named myself.
Thank you, brother. Thank you. I think the participants have now figured out why we're having this webinar. Because we planned this all along. They're like, oh, that was the game. But this was not planned. And thank you so much. Thank you so much, Saad. So I think let's take some of the questions that have come in. I think one interesting one I see, Amin Sajwani has asked basically, since QR is not really working here, what's your take on contactless payment? What do you see the future of contactless tap and pay payment here in Pakistan?
पहले तो number one I'll say ऐसा नहीं है QR will never work. QR will work with the right approach. With QR you need instant settlements, right? With instant settlements you also need that you know we need some support from state bank or government level, probably most likely government support. That you know when a person adopts a QR and a QR transaction, what good will he get out of it? What good will that do to his business that a cash can't? Obviously, that is your banking trail. Now, once you have a banking trail, you can get credit. And credit is the name of the game. And we shy away from it as a society for various reasons. I'll not go into that. But sure. That is how the business and this economy grows. And this is what is missing in the society. The disbursement.
Sir, my point of view on static QR is that it's not going to work. It's not going to work in Pakistan. I think the user experience is horrible.
I'm coming to that. You see, the merchant adoption and user experience. You see, you can teach a merchant how to use a particular app. It may take a bit of while, maybe 2 days or so, but they get the drift. Right. It's the consumer that is more affected by the user experience, UI and UX. And you are right over there. A consumer will be able to adopt to it if it's localized, if it's more number literate and all, you know, the phone usage is easier because it's all numbers. So number one, so answering, I would say QR will fly, but when we do it the right time, the third time, see, that is how it happened in China. In China, it was not a success the first two times. I think we should stop following China. We should rather reach the end part. That is how they did it the third time. And that is how it happened. And number two, contactless payments. It is you see another way of doing a transaction. So after chip and pin, contactless will serve the purpose. Yes, contactless is going to be very effective. Kinu is the only entity right now whose entire network is contactless capable. And inshallah, after a couple of months, we'll be accepting Visa, Master, and Union Pay, all of those contactless payments on our terminals. Our certifications are almost complete, so we'll be rolling it out. Contactless
when
will
you
have
think contactless will come by and large in Pakistan. When will other acquirers also start rolling it out?
By this year end, I suppose everybody should be ready. But entire network cannot. We were lucky. We were later entrants, and we realized it about 6 years ago that one day contactless will be the end thing. Will be, you know, it'll require certain improvement. That has happened now. So our network from day one was contactless enabled. But I think other players, to be fair with them, they have legacy network, and it takes some time and money to change it. So probably entire country would be contactless enabled by next year end, 100% contactless enablement. And that will definitely help in user experience and transactions and, you know, cutting off long lines at certain merchant locations.
Okay, interesting. Okay, another question that's come in, and I actually wanted to ask you myself. You've recently, mashallah, gotten the in-principle approval for an EMI. What are your plans around those? Because you seem to be moving or adding another vertical to your business, which is consumer-facing. So what's the plan? What are the plans?
See, as far as Kinu is concerned, Kinu is all about merchants, right? But merchants do have a consumer side to them. Right. And there are lots and lots of use cases that are around that consumer side of merchants. Lastly, we believe that, you know, remittances could be handled in a much different way, the way they were. And we have a model of our own, which is currently in discussion with State Bank. Once we get a go ahead, we'll go ahead and launching that as well. So our thing is to promote the acquiring business to supplement and support it. We would be offering our consumer wallet and our merchant wallet. It will be pretty different to the Sada Pay wallet and other players' wallet because you will be going all
so.
Out. No, you'll be going all out for the consumer space. But in fact, I would say that Kinu wallet would be a very good complement to the Sada Pay wallet, because our use cases will be less consumption, more towards facilitation of our current and future merchant base.
Okay, interesting. I think that we have two questions. Shabir Baksamusa Saab, I used to work with him in Abin Amra Bank Sounds, and I think Ahad are both asking related questions regarding QR. So Shabir Saab's question is, why exactly has QR failed in inverted commas in our market? And then Ahad is asking, what is the right way to do QR for any bank in Pakistan? I'll give my two cents, and then obviously Saad's the expert. I think, Shabir Saab, QR has failed in our market because I personally believe that static QR in our market is not something that is viable, because what are you doing is that the user experience from the consumer point of view is horrible, because what has to happen is, currently what happens when you give a card to the merchant does everything. He swipes it or dips it. He keys in the amount. He maybe hands it over to you to enter the PIN, and that's it. You know, it's a passive thing for a consumer. But with a static QR, what you as a consumer have to do is everything, which is actually scan the QR, first of all. So you need to have a 3G, 4G connection working on your phone. It's okay. So you scan it. You open the app first. You open your payment app. You scan the QR. You then enter the amount, which I feel is a no-go in Pakistan. Because if me as a consumer, I get one of the decimals wrong, so a 420 rupee payment turns into a 42,000 rupee payment. By mistake, or maybe a 4,200 rupee payment by mistake, and then it's a huge problem. And then I enter the PIN, and then an OTP comes, and banks put a lot of security on the consumer side. So the entire burden of the transaction is on the consumer. How I feel that QR can do well is dynamic QR. So what happens is the merchant generates the QR, which has all the details. A, it has the details of the merchant and their accounts, for example. It also has the amount, which is critical. So all I have to do as a consumer is I open up my app and I scan that QR. It pops up, okay, do you want to pay 420 rupees to XYZ store? And I just press yes or no, right? And so all I have to do is press maybe two buttons and I'm done. And so I think that sort of answers both the questions. And maybe Saad, if you want to add something to that, why has it failed in our market, and what's the right way of doing it?
Yeah, I think you've generally covered it. If I sum it up, you mean friction primarily, right?
Yeah.
The friction was is the biggest issue. Likewise, what I said was, when you're launching a product like QR and you're going towards a customer that has never been termized or has never been digitized, I would rather say, then you have to give him some incentive, not a short-lived incentive, an incentive that he can carry on for a longer time and then adopt it completely. See, Omar, you have attended a lot of seminars, and there's a talk about Panwala. It has become a lingo. POS or a digital acceptance at a Panwala. That's not going to happen till you equate it or make a digital instrument greater value than cash. Hence, I again say, less valuable. Cash should be less valuable. So QR was launched for those people. Then there was infrastructure issues. You see, it was all SMS based. As you said, the QR is supposed to be riding on the same infrastructure, like I say, POS. Why can't you do? Why can't you just let go of the static QR and do a QR transaction via POS? Right? It's going to be a dynamic QR, and there's going to be less friction. Then there was a big issue. I'll come down to a very practical thing, and that were fuel stations. So the biggest target for a QR were fuel stations, right? What happened was that in Pakistan, how the transaction works, that the person who fills up your tank then enters the amount himself, right, in a machine, and accepts your card. He does it all himself. He doesn't leave anything on the customer. And static QRs, everything was in the entire thing was in the hands of the consumer who was filling up the tank. And then comes the part of errors. Now I'll come down to basic reasons, because Baksa Musa Saab is very well aware of what I'm talking about. See, then it came down to what about error? What about chargebacks? What about disputes? How do we handle that? Now, POS transaction is very mature in that regard. You could void a transaction. You could, you know, initiate reversals, auto reversals, very, very fine mechanisms that associations have, you know, taught us and have, I mean, PayPark also follows the same. In QR, all that was absent. So I think it was done primarily in haste. If we take a step back, we work on the use cases, we solve these frictions, as you mentioned, and we solve the problem of equating it with cash, it will fly. It will definitely fly. Probably in a year's time, we will progress 10 years ahead. So that's my answer.
Right. Excellent. You also touched upon lending for merchants. We've been hearing about this concept for a while. Do you think that this could ever really become a reality? Because the way banks, at least, are lending in Pakistan is super old-fashioned. It's still the same product program that Citibank brought out in the mid-90s. All they've done is just control, find, replace the name of Citibank with their bank. Do you feel that this sort of digital lending based on merchant data, do you think that any bank is ready for it? Or do EMIs EMIs are not allowed to lend, but maybe NBFCs should step into this domain and do it? Or do you think banks have that appetite if we provide them the data?
See, Umar, I mean, the kind of situation that we are in as an industry and as a country, there's always going to be chicken and egg problems. See, that is for sure, 100%. But I'm very glad that right now I can give examples of success stories of our neighboring countries. I would like to name India. A digital wallet in India, probably, you know, number of consumer-wise 12th number is profitable wallet. All they do is they do merchant lending. So merchant lending is the key for, and how could that happen? Right now, even the metrics are absent when you talk about lending to the merchant. Banks, I 100% agree, are not right now positioned, or their processes or their strategies from the board level is not aligned with lending to the merchant. Now, that is where the government and regulatory bodies have to step in and mandate. Because you see, what we are doing right now is just scraping the surface. For economy to take a turnaround, for people to become, to build viable businesses, to become rich. I mean, same problem lies with e-commerce. You see, in Pakistan, the rates have fallen down because of COVID. Otherwise, the discount rates were as high as you can find in the region. How could an e-commerce player, I mean, I'm collating it with a general merchant. How could an e-commerce player, by taking a loan that will cost him around 20% or 19% and take out other expenses like utility bills and the salaries of staff and everything, can make money out of it? E-tailing will never replace retailing when you have to cater to all this, and then mature business will keep on thriving and making money. Small businesses, which are basically the backbone of your economy, will never thrive. So here I say again, it is of utmost importance that banks are to be restructured. Regulatory bodies and government have to really take it on as a challenge and do it very, very quickly. And what is the loss? Government also gets lending from banks, don't they? Okay, fine. They have a sovereign guarantee of their own selves behind it, but it's not doing much good to the economy as far as growth is concerned and future viability is concerned. For future viability, every bank has to, you know, keep a certain size of their book. I mean, probably, you know, 5% of their entire book into for these, as they say, risky lending. I don't believe it's risky, because if you look at numbers of microfinance lending, the NPLs are probably times lower than conventional loans. So I think they have to be priced properly as well. And I would go on to say, you know, I'll just give you an example. So a hardware store retailer, we have done our research on this. If he has a business volume of around 50,000 a month, I mean, the profit is about 50,000 a month, and you give him a loan of about 500,000 rupees, and that amount rises to around 90,000 a month. Now you could become partners in that. Now that will change our entire investment banking concept, and how it is implemented, and what is risk, what is hedging. Now, we as a country have to do it, and banks are part of this country. We need to realize this. No one entity could do it. It's not a fashion statement of sorts. It is a serious issue. government has to realize it. Banks have to restructure. We as fintechs have to be very, very nimble. We have to have that technology that we can share the right amount of metrics with them. They could lend, we could make money, they could make money, the country will thrive. That is probably the only formula of success over here.
Interesting. I think you use the word should a lot. Banks should do this, banks should do that. I think that the challenge of me and you, for example, stepping out of the industry, there's a lot of shoulds out there, but unfortunately there's a lack of execution.
We are only human beings, Umar. We can't take burden of the entire world, can we?
I know that's true. But what I'm saying is that maybe the NBFC model is something that can work hand in hand with EMIs or companies like you. Because you have data. We'll inshallah be having a lot of data of our users. We're also going into acquiring of sorts. So I think that if we can have enough data, I think that the NBFC license allows third parties to start thinking about lending in this area. I just feel that waiting That's for banks to do this, yeah, waiting for banks to do this is something that at least my hair will be like yours by the time that happens. So
I look good in this, actually.
That's true. So that's what I'm saying. I'm not saying that I'd look bad, but I'm saying I would have no hair. So I think great conversation. I think that we still have a few minutes here. So what do you think that the future or the immediate future is? I think you mentioned that there'll be 90,000, close to 90,000 POSs by year end. I think that is amazing.
Financial year end.
Okay. But that's still, that's like doubling the numbers. I think that one of the things that always disturbs people when they talk about number of POSs is actually number of locations. How many unique locations do we have in Pakistan, Saad? Can you solve that mystery for us, please?
Yeah, it's right now about 22,000.
22,000 unique locations. Now, in the targets that State Bank has given these acquiring banks, is it talking about unique locations or is just talking about?
No, it's not. They're not talking about unique locations because you see that would create more complexity and it could never have been achieved because then you would have problems relating to unique location. If one bank approaches that unique location, how could you stop another one from getting good business out of that?
That's true.
That's destroying the market rather. So,
although if you think about it, since State Bank has basically capped the MDR at 1.5, I mean, it's a range, but the market will just tilt towards 1.5, right? All the merchants will ask for that MDR. If for example, you go and you put your machine at 1.5, even though you say that you charge extra for value additions, let's for the time being put that aside and you put it at 1.5. Why would the merchant then be approached by HBL or say yes to HBL or any other bank? And because the rate is going to be the same, they can't undercut you. So don't you think that this by default, that kind of State Bank has kind of taken care of that unique location aspect?
See, I can be the best person to answer this. Why? Because when we entered into the acquiring business, we were the fifth player in the market. And after 3 years, we have about 22% share in the market. Alhamdulillah. You see, it's acquiring business, when you read about it, is different. And when you do it, it's very, very different. It's poles apart. Merchants are willing to pay when you solve certain of their problems or you create some solutions that could give them opportunity. That's beyond solving problems. So if HBL places a machine over there, no merchant would ever, take a risk of placing one acquirer at its outlet because certain times there's the technical malfunctions, they shift to others and stuff like that, divide the business. What HBL or other banks have is they have other banking products to cross-sell and offer. What we have is our technical superiority and our nimbleness, and we can offer them greater solutions. And being a neutral entity, bring other issuers to the merchants. So it's a balance, it's a battle, it's going to keep on happening. But as an industry, we will also benefit from it and Pakistan will also benefit from it. So it's going to be a very good competition. But you see, competition has to be done with sanity. It should not be hurting the turf that we are playing on. See, we haven't come to the ground, we haven't come to the cricket match. और जब टूर्नामेंट हो रहा होता है तो उसमें मल्टीपल पार्टीज आपस में खेलती हैं, कोई जीता है हारता है, लेकिन एंड में क्रिकेट जीत जाता है। तो पहले ही हो रहा था कि पार्टीज जीत तो रही थी लेकिन क्रिकेट हार रहा था, ठीक है जी। सो अब ये जो सैनिटी लेके आया स्टेट बैंक, इसके बाद अब इन्वेस्टमेंट हम भी कर सकेंगे, हम अट्रैक्ट भी करेंगे, क्योंकि देखिए द रियलिटी इज आई विल बी वेरी वेरी ओपन एंड अपफ्रंट, यू सी पाकिस्तान में रियलिटी क्या है, बिकॉज ऑफ द रिस्कीनेस दैट पाकिस्तान हैज एज अ कंट्री, इंशाल्लाह आई होप इट गेट्स बेटर एंड आई एम श्योर इट विल। FATF में हम ग्रे लिस्ट पे हैं। होता क्या है कि जनरली कोई बाहर का इन्वेस्टर आता है तो कहता है जी इज आर यू मेकिंग मनी, नो सर वी विल स्टार्ट मेकिंग मनी बिकॉज ऑफ XYZ, ऑल गोज डाउन द ड्रेन, ट्रस्ट मी, एंड आई हैव हैड लॉट ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस इन दिस। आई मीन आई हैव द मोस्ट एक्सपीरियंस इन दिस बिकॉज आई एम अराउंड, आई बीन अराउंड जब लोगों को फिनटेक का नाम भी नहीं पता था पाकिस्तान में, NFC कॉन्टेक्टलेस का नहीं पता था और फिनटेक का नहीं पता था। मैं ये बता रहा हूँ कि आपका मॉडल ठीक होना चाहिए जब आप इतना केपेक्स इंटेंसिव बिजनेस में आ रहे हैं। देखिए वॉलेट का प्ले अलग होता है, दैट्स नॉट केपेक्स इंटेंसिव टू दैट एक्सटेंट, आपका टेक का खर्चा है। यहाँ पे मैं मशीन्स का खर्चा कर रहा हूँ, उन मशीन्स का कोई और यूसेज नहीं है, ऐसा नहीं है कि ये मशीन उठा के कल को मोबाइल फोन बन जाएगा, ठीक है। सो इसका मुनाफे में आना बड़ा जरूरी था, एक ग्रॉस लॉस में चल रहे थे तमाम बिजनेसेस, तमाम के तमाम। HBL हम लोग, अल्फला, वी आर द टॉप थ्री, बाकी UBL एंड MCB सब ग्रॉस लॉस में चल रहे थे। और इस रिजीम चेंज के बाद भी कुछ चीजें हैं जो हमें आहिस्ता आहिस्ता देखनी पड़ेंगी, जैसे कि हम कब तक डॉलर में पेमेंट्स करते रहेंगे, राइट। द एसोसिएशंस आल्सो हैव टू वर्क विद अस, आई एम नॉट सेइंग राइट नाउ, हमें भी ट्रैक्शन दिखानी है, बट हम डॉलर की पेमेंट कब तक करते रहेंगे भाई। पाकिस्तान में डॉलर जब हमने कंपनी शुरू की थी 103 पे था, आज 160 पे है, ठीक है जी। तो मैं तो 60% तो लॉस में आ गया ना, राइट। सो व्हाई वुड आई डू दिस बिजनेस, इट हैज टू मेक सेंस, इट हैज टू मेक सेंस फॉर द स्पॉन्सर। लाइकवाइज बहुत सारे और मेजर्स हैं जिसके अंदर आता है जी कि हमें, जैसे मैंने कहा, इंस्टेंट सेटलमेंट ऑफ मर्चेंट, स्टेट बैंक इज ऑलरेडी वर्किंग ऑन इट, बट एज सून एज दैट हैपेंस ये और स्पाइक करेगा। अच्छा फिर हम क्या कर रहे थे, हम पांचों प्लेयर एक छोटी सी टफ पे लड़ रहे थे, वी विल बी फोर्स टू फाइंड न्यू एवेन्यूज, फाइंड न्यू एरियाज, KLI, मुल्तान, हैदराबाद, सखर, भावलपुर, इस्लामाबाद, पेशावर, इनके आगे हम नहीं बढ़ रहे थे, बाकी इसके आगे दुनिया बहुत बड़ी हो गई है। यू सी, मुझे याद है द बिजनेस केस दैट वी मेड, एंड आई एम रियली शेमफुल व्हेन आई से दिस एंड आई अपोलोजाइज टू पीपल फ्रॉम मुल्तान, हमने मुल्तान को टीयर 2 सिटी लिखा हुआ था, और जब हमने मुल्तान में तफसीली जायजा लिया और हम वहां रहे तो हमें अंदाजा हुआ भाई इट्स अ शेम टू कॉल इट अ टीयर 2 सिटी। आई मीन सर्टन कराची, पाकिस्तान की सर्टन सिटीज से बहुत बेहतर इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर है वहां पे और स्पेंडिंग भी अच्छी है। यू सी, हम अब हम सोचेंगे, पहले हम क्या कह रहे थे, जाओ यार जाके जरा रेट कम कर दो, 10 पैसे तुम कम कर दो, मशीन लगा दो, मैंने टारगेट पूरा करना जी, मैं प्रोडक्ट मैनेजर हूँ, ठीक है। इस चीज से हमें बिजनेस मेंटेलिटी में जब हम आएंगे तो हम कहेंगे देखें जी सैनिटी लेके आए, टर्फ वॉर ऐसी नहीं होती कि जिसमें आप ग्राउंड को खड्डा कर दें, शॉर्ट बात यह है जी।
Hey, thank you, Saad. Very, very honest and upfront as always. Some people are calling this regulation a silent revolution, and I think that we all agree that this is a fantastic thing that State Bank has done. I think it will definitely improve the acquiring margins. It will improve thought processes within acquiring companies, and we're definitely EMIs. Issuing EMIs like SaadaPay and others are really looking towards you, Saad. To make this cricket ground, like the Melbourne cricket ground, it has to be huge, and there has to have 80,000 people coming in and watching it, and so that we have a thriving ecosystem of digital payments.
Inshallah.
Saad Niazi, thank you so much. It was an engaging talk as always. I think we had a lot of panelists participants come in. Thank you all for joining us. We shall inshallah see you in another episode of Rising FinTech.
One more thing, Umar, before you end it, Pakistan FinTech Association is going to be a reality and you will be the first president, inshallah. Okay, please include me in it. Thank
you. I won't pick up your call, buddy.
Take care. Bye.
Okay. Allah Hafiz.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for joining us.